something real, girl.
Say something real.
Do 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 do, baby.
Say something real. Say something real. Say something real.
Good morning, welcome to Say Something Real. With Ms. Michelle Bryant. I'm Keith Paris. I'm sitting in for Michelle today. I want to welcome everybody to the program this morning. Our phone lines open, 414-444-5250. 414-444-5250. It's going to take me a while to get my bearings, man. So this is what 7 o'clock in the morning looks like, huh? All right. So we're all here. Good morning, brothers. What's happening again? What's happening, y'all?
Good morning. Okay. You got it there.
I got my coffee. And, who is it? Is it Dorothy that calls? They might have to add a little something to my coffee. That's usually Dorothy, right? Early in the morning. How you been, Brother Rhino?
Well, man, I've been blessed, man. I can't complain, man. I'm still counting sheep.
Staying out of trouble?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I'm staying out of complete trouble, man.
I'm sitting here. I mean, you look like you thought you'd figured out why I was sitting here. I thought
that you was a statue or something.
No, you ain't thought that, man.
Okay.
Too early for jokes.
Yeah, right. Nah, we got to get it going, man. We got to get it rolling.
Man,
I got 4 hours. I need all the jokes. Man. I need all the help. So, any contributions?
Watch Bill Carvey come flying down Capitol.
Yeah. That cat was doing 90.
I was okay. I was right behind him. I saw him at the door. I'm like, okay, I'm
yeah,
all right.
Yeah, that's you were right behind him. You probably was in a good place if you was behind him.
Yeah. I hear some stories.
If you look at that car, it'll tell you some stories. Have you noticed his car right out?
I saw the front
end. Bumper gone. Not a back one hanging.
Oh my God.
Yeah, he just. Got somebody the other day.
He was like, excuse me, I got to keep going.
I got to go to work.
I'll let y'all later.
Excuse me, it's an emergency. I got to get to work.
He rough, boy, I tell you.
Oh, man.
I wait till he leave, then I leave once he's gone.
Oh, yeah.
Right. Safe distance, right?
Yeah. Let him go.
414-444-5250. 414-444-5250. Inside, say something real.
Hey, man, we were just talking about this before you got here, man. Me and Jermaine, I have and Jermaine admitted that he does as well. He has a phobia going across bridges. Did you see that, man?
Oh, man.
Unbelievable.
And I've been on that bridge.
Wow.
Really?
I've been on that bridge. Yep.
Wow.
That's the bridge that takes you to 695. And then, just in case, folks, if you hadn't heard, there has been the Francis Scott Key Bridge. Should have named after him anyway. Collapsed a barge. What a boat hit it.
Yeah.
Took it down.
Yeah.
And right now they're saying they think there are about 7 people that's still in the water. But this happened at, would have been midnight our time, about 1:40 their time. And they've been in the water now 5 hours. So they were talking about the fear of hypothermia.
Because they said the water temperature is about 45 degrees.
How you can, and I was, as I was coming in listening to CNN, they said that an eyewitness said that the lights flickered on the ship and then it just ran right into the barge.
Wow.
Right into the support, the expanse, and the whole bridge just collapsed.
I saw the footage this morning. It was like, wow.
And it could have been during the middle of the day in Francis Scott Key in Baltimore, the inner harbor.
Maryland.
Man, I'm gonna be honest with you, man. That's always been one of my biggest fears, is because I know when I was living in Carolina, you know, going over to the beaches, whatever, you got to go over this bridge, you know, and it's
in South Carolina.
Yeah. Been on that one too.
This bridge, and this bridge, there's no railings on the side, so it's nothing but water on both sides, but it's traffic going both ways.
Yeah.
And when I tell you it's one of the scariest experiences, I drove in the middle.
In between lanes.
I drove in the middle because it's so scary.
Yeah, you can get a ticket for that, man.
Hey, man, give me the ticket. I would rather get the ticket than to be pulled out of water. I'm cool.
And the crazy thing is after 9/11, they didn't allow trucks with hazardous material to go through the tunnels. So now they got to figure out how they're going to deal with that traffic. Do you let them go through the tunnels?
But they were saying that bridge is a major thoroughfare, if you will, for
31,000 cars.
Even transport. So there's going to be some issues with how they get this, you know, different products and so forth delivered to.
Yeah, the 695 is kind of like their beltway. Mm-hmm. Kind of, I mean, you understand these six numbers, they kind of go in a circle and it kind of goes around DC. I think it is 395, but that's the circle. So let me ask you this.
Have you ever driven to New Orleans?
No, which is going to be interesting because we're talking to Mitch Landrieu later today. That was one of the things. I've never been to New Orleans.
Have you been, Jermaine?
Yes.
Have you ever ridden across? I think it's 10.
No, I flew. I wasn't.
Oh, you're talking about going across the Mississippi?
I think it takes you across Lake Pontchartrain.
Okay.
Yeah, and it is... when you speak to seeming like you right there in the water.
Oh my God. Yeah.
I think the bridge is about 20-30 miles long, man. So ain't no exits. You're not getting off.
Yeah. It's the same way in Carolina. It's like it goes all the way over and all the way across. It's like it's scary. It's the most scariest thing I ever seen. But I was bad enough
being on that bridge. But guess who I was on the bridge with?
Who?
Ella Wallace.
Oh, it's over with.
Making catfish bait.
It's over with.
In the motorhome.
How was Elda Wallace dead?
Right. Oh, that cat was 1,000.
When I was a kid, he was old.
Jesus.
And there were certain people, and God rest his soul, but there were certain people that, you know, you just, Mattie Bell Woods is another one.
My mama
said when she was young, Mattie Bell was old. So, and, you know, and Mattie Bell was getting around here in her 90s.
She was. Main event, that was her. That was her spot. Her and Jimmy, what was his name?
Jimmy Mack.
Yeah. You go up there.
I was trying to think
of him. The House of Hospitality.
Oh, and if you were regular there, you had a little mug.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, right up there on the wall with your name on it.
Wow.
Yeah, we used to do Tavern Thursday there quite a bit.
Okay.
With the other station that I worked for, and there's some talk, guys, of Tavern Thursday coming back, man.
Oh wow. Is that right?
Yeah, there's some talk of it coming back, man.
Know what? And I know how we got, but this is interesting. Have you ever did a pub crawl?
Of course.
How did you do it on the bike? You know, they do the pedaling on the bus. It was on a bus or in the van.
Bus.
Yeah, when the weather's nice, they had those. I don't know if you've seen those
bicycle bars. Yeah, I've seen those.
And they're doing the pub crawl.
That's mainly on the south side, though.
Not River West. Third Ward.
Yeah, see, I don't go down there. I don't go down there.
Third Ward is very nice.
I might be.
You seafood guy, right?
I love seafood.
You go to St. Paul's Fish Market?
No, haven't been there.
Oh man,
that's nice.
Yeah, people, and I'm not. I can't.
Were they at the public market or were they?
Yeah, they're on the Broadway side of it.
Then I think I've been there.
And they do now. I can't eat shrimp, but they do a shrimp po' boy. I see people there, and then there's another thing that they do. They're lobster or something.
Mm.
Yeah, they got great fish though.
Lobster bisque. Are you familiar with that?
I've heard of it, but I've never
awesome.
Had it.
A great lobster.
You like seafood? Bisque.
I love it.
See, I don't eat lobster.
You got something against lobster?
It just look funny to me.
You eat chitlins?
And you got to.
Nah.
You got to eat chitlins.
I smelt it. I don't like it.
They cook them live.
The lobster? Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Cook them live.
Yeah.
So. I'm cool, man. I don't want to see nothing die.
I haven't done it in a while. I used to go to Syndic's when they were down on Oakland. And I would go and pick my lobster out, man, and take him home and do him in.
So you ain't never felt sorry for the lobster?
No.
Like you didn't just look at it and had that face?
No.
You never felt sorry for the chicken?
Yeah, dock that bird, man. I felt sorry for that bird when it was going down.
Well, I'm going to tell
somebody
you.
Somebody had to do something. That bird, man.
Somebody had to do something. Barnyard pimp.
Yeah. The barnyard pimp.
That bird.
That bird that built a miniature church.
Oh, my God.
Oh, that's what I was going to think. You know, back in the day, you used to sacrifice a dove. Yeah. Or the bird for black people was the chicken.
Listen here.
Yes, sir.
Bring him on, Doc. Season them up with Lawry's.
Okay. The interesting thing was, man, when I grew up, we ate chicken 4 days a week. So I said, when I was an adult, I'm never going to eat chicken again.
You still eat chicken.
Wrong. I became a black preacher.
You know what that means?
Right. Chicken on Sunday. Right, chicken, you know, on
chicken on Sunday. Like, you got some, you got some chicken.
Yes. Well, Pastor, I fried some chicken today.
What time you want me there, Sister So and So?
You don't see him scratching his neck though.
Yeah, I see.
It's all white. You got some.
He having a
looking like Tyrone Bigum. You got some chicken.
Man, there's something about that bird, man.
There's
so many different ways you can prepare it, though. I mean, that's just you know, in salads and different ways that you can utilize it. And that the bird just he don't stand a chance.
Listen. When I was a little guy, I was down in Tennessee living with my uncle and aunt. And they call them spring chickens, but they're young chickens. And I got a chicken. I kind of got attached to the chicken. You know, me and him be out playing in the yard.
Oh, Lord, I know where this is going.
You know where it's going. My Aunt Willie went out there, boy, grabbed that chicken, rang his neck.
Broke that neck.
And then put it on the table. And, like, I'm going to eat two piece. Come on, man. That's my buddy. I'm going to eat two piece.
Say, sorry, Charles.
Sorry, man. And so she had to send my uncle in the town to get some chicken from the butcher, because he said, that boy ain't going to eat that chicken. No, I just played with him yesterday, man.
He broke his neck. In a WB.
Right. But no, you talk about scary bridges, though. I don't know if you've ever been on the Golden Gate.
I've been on the Golden Gate.
I've heard
about Golden Gate.
I've been on the Golden Gate.
And then there's there's some bridges that are just long expanses. I think they have a bridge in Tampa that's like
Bay Bridge. The Bay Bridge ain't short-stopping either.
Oh, the one going into Oakland?
Yeah. Oakland, San Francisco, that bridge right there.
Bay Bridge.
Because it's a double-decker.
Right. And remember when they had the earthquake?
Yeah. I used to live there, so I had recently got back here. Because that was one of the reasons I decided to come back to Milwaukee, man. My first earthquake, I said, no, this ain't for me.
And that was the beginning of the World Series. It was a Bay Series. It was Frisco against Oakland.
Yeah.
And they had to postpone it. But when you see that bridge, and I don't even know if they still do that design.
Yeah, it's not as smart, because the top actually collapsed to the bottom.
You came right down on those folks in the cars, and they're going. Yeah.
Man. And then let me ask you this. Not to shift gears. No. Keith, you got that?
Because you're not going to make the point.
Yeah, but I was going to ask this question before we had shift gears from about the barnyard pimp.
Yeah.
We were talking about churches and, you know, how many churches have been built.
Yeah.
Do you remember, Jermaine, when everybody got sick after eating the church dinner?
They had a church.
Pastor was sick. Yeah. Everybody was sick.
Yeah. I heard about that.
Where was this?
Where did we go?
Oh, your church.
Miracle Temple Church.
It was a miracle.
Oh, doctor, listen here.
It's amazing more people don't get sick.
One of the cooks, I won't call her name, but I did just then. Her name was Mother Cook. That was her name, Mother Cook.
She sent the cook.
She made some dressings with them onions and eggs and stuff in
onions.
There.
Onions.
And left it sit out.
Oh, man.
Too long.
Yeah.
And so by the time everybody came down to have the family dinner, it had spoiled.
I hope it wasn't after a funeral.
No, it was Sunday service. It was a friends and family day.
Oh, Lord. You're killing the guests. So you're killing the guests.
The next morning, I'm in the bathroom. My great aunt, Mother Sprawl, she come by. She said, you got to come out of there.
Yeah.
I got to go. I said, well, I can't do nothing for you right now, Auntie. I can't come out of here right now. The pastor was sick. And after that is when he implemented that if you was handling money, you couldn't handle the food, and he just put all kind of parameters in place, because his stomach was tore up too. You don't remember that, Jermaine?
I remember that. I do remember that.
You was a little guy, though.
I was a little guy, probably like 4 or 5 years old, but I'm sure everybody in my house was sick, because, you know, my dad and mom was faithful.
Oh, yeah. They ate it too.
Every Sunday and Tuesday and Friday.
Man, don't mention it.
Jesus.
I'm be doing like Pastor Paris,
right, scratching my neck.
Sunday night, YPWW, prayer and Bible band.
Oh my God,
man, did they have enough services? They don't seem to do all of that.
You know, it's funny. My pastor said what he would do. He was down in Tennessee.
Mm-hmm.
He would go to YPWW
mm-hmm.
and then get over to BTU.
Now, what is BTU?
What's BTU?
Baptist Training Union. That's your YPWW.
Oh, yeah. Okay, yeah.
Oh, it was the Young People's Willing Workers.
Young People Willing Workers.
Yeah, yeah.
Right. And our equivalent to that was the Baptist Training Union.
So he would go to somebody's YPWW and then go.
I spent a lot of time in Church of God in Christ.
I know you did, but you wasn't going for BTU or YPW.
I love the Lord.
Yeah, no, you did.
It was some
girls too that cried.
Oh, dude, I was talking. And you know what? The greatest thing ever happened when I joined the choir. Because now I got a reason to be over there.
It was amazing to me, you know, coming up in Rehoboth. We sang in our church choir and what have you. Yeah. But man, when I joined the state youth choir, the doors went to opening up and so forth, and you know, you were visiting this church and y'all were traveling, and it changed my life, man.
Man, listen,
I'm so ecumenical. You know, I am non-denominational.
Do me a favor though, with those big words. Me and Jermaine probably gonna need you to break that down. What's
ecumenical?
Yeah, ecumenical.
This means that I'm not beholden necessarily to one particular religious
belief. Okay.
As in relates to Christendom.
Right.
So, I mean, I used to go to the Jehovah's Witness halls.
I visited like the Jehovah's a couple of times with my family.
I loved the reading part of it.
Well, you know what I didn't care about so much was the look that my cousins who were Jehovah's Witnesses had around birthdays and holidays and stuff. They couldn't celebrate it.
Right.
I just couldn't understand why religion, you know, would separate. I know you weren't supposed to. You really couldn't even.
It's not in the Bible.
Yep. What, to celebrate your birthday?
It's not in the Bible.
So if it's not in the book, you don't recognize it.
Those holidays, they don't. Christmas is not in the Bible. Easter's not in the Bible. So I mean, talking as
so pagan recognized holidays is basically what you call
it? Well, Christianity adopted that under Constantine. You're right. Those were pretty much pagan practices. Mm-hmm. If the early church was really still practicing Jews, mm-hmm. so then they were on the Jewish festival, you know, the Tabernacle of the Feast, Yom Kippur, those things. But there was no Christmas and there was no Easter.
That's Steve. You know why the popping roll cans?
You know what happened to
you? You know what, Steve? You're on the air, man.
Oh.
Oh, he didn't know he was on there? You can't bring Steve up early. You got to. Go ahead, caller. You're on the air, man.
Anyway, y'all talking all that stuff, and I was a member of Westside Church of God in Christ Choir, and we used to travel, and that's all we ate was bird. No matter where you went, they're going to feed you some chicken.
That's right. Now, which West Side? Were you over on St. Paul, or were you at
St. Paul to Always Our Avenue.
Oh, okay.
Wow. Okay, my mama moved on 26 in Concordia.
Oh, she right down the street.
Oh, man. I got a great Marvin Winans story. So Bishop Hines and Marvin Winans, they've been friends since forever.
Yeah.
And when they both started preaching, you know. So then Elder Hines invited Elder Winans over to preach. It was a revival. So he got up and if I say Daryl's, no disrespect, but everybody was doing this, that little riff that Marvin used to do. This thing. And so he's trying to, so he introduced him. Marvin Winans gets up and he said that at 8:20, I'm going to sit down. Well, preachers tell that lie every time. Two lies we gonna tell. We ain't gonna be up long, and I'm about to close. Right, it's two lies we gonna tell every sermon. So we prepare. Here come another. There's another lie. So he was at, man. He was like almost there, and it was 8:20, and he sat down. Daryl Hines got up. He said, "Man, I know what you told us, but you gonna finish this message."
He was in that thing,
and he got back up.
Yeah, he wanted somebody to get it back up.
Oh man, we did so good. Why you quitting?
Yeah.
Now there's some you wonder why they even started. you know where we going with this is kind of, but it was just like I was saying the same thing. Get him back up, Daryl. Get him back up, man. I ain't got no place to go. Come on, the kids got to go to school.
What an interesting time to grow up, though.
Yeah.
In Kojic and just in church in general. Because there were so many greats that we look back now, the Jeffrey LaValleys and the Fred Whites and the different ones that have certainly left their mark.
Well, who's still on gospel?
Shirley Barti as well.
Hey, but you know what though? Jeffrey LaValley is my kinfolks.
Is that right?
Yeah, it's my blood cousin.
Okay.
So it's a lot musically, the history here in the city. A lot of people don't know, but my family it's rooted in a lot of the history here in the city. So
the Daniels, all of them, I grab them all around.
Let me give the late Elder Frank Johnson. He coined the term when he was talking about his daughters. He said they were Pentabaptists. Because they spent as much time. Yes, that's right. Spent as much time in Baptist churches as they did in churches of God in Christ. And I think one of the interesting pieces was that many of our musicians, in terms of the Baptist church, would come out of either the Church of God in Christ or the Pentecostal church.
You know what amazes me now? I see it more, and it may have been prevalent then, but a lot of the musicians, how they just bounce from church to church to play.
Oh, yeah. They're professionals.
Yeah, yeah. But I mean, back then, you didn't see that as much. You, typically, your musician was a member of your church.
We had a lot of musicians, but I'm going to tell you, there was a period that it got very difficult, and that was like the mid-80s into the 90s because of AIDS. Mm-hmm. And we lost a lot of musicians.
A whole lot of musicians.
Yeah.
We lost a lot of them because Ella Wallace said, "Get out of here."
Oh, man, listen.
He didn't allow that, man.
I got some stories to tell.
I'm going to squeeze this in before y'all go to commercial.
Go ahead, brother.
We used to have our confrontations, I mean, our whatever, anniversaries at Rehoboth. And Shirley Bertief will play for us. And Freddie White used to be our organist.
Mm-hmm.
And I was working at I Love Shoes, and then Daryl Hands and all of them started coming there. That's how we became friends. Mm. That's how I met him.
Well, Daryl ended up managing I Lots down on Third Street. Yeah.
What about Arlene Newsom?
She was awesome.
Go back to Parkman with her.
Yeah.
Arlene Newsom. Yeah.
Wisconsin Community Choir.
Yeah.
Oh my God. Now here's a choir that didn't require a warm up.
No, they didn't.
These Negroes came in the door.
Yeah.
Right. They was ready to go coming in the dope.
And what was amazing as a kid, George Walford.
George.
So George was my uncle.
Yeah.
He lived upstairs over me.
Okay.
And we had this big basement down there. So sometimes the choir would rehearse in my basement.
Wow.
Yeah. So I got a chance to know a lot of those guys, man, just as a kid growing up. George taught me how to tie my tie.
We have a lot of history.
We rooted in there, man.
Yeah, Doc. Yeah.
We got a lot of history.
You're inside. Say something real.
A lot of church history.
Yes, sir.
I be listening at y'all. I be listening.
Steve, thank you so much, man. We're going to head to break, man. Appreciate
y'all
have a good one. Keep listening. Thank you.
Right. We're inside. Say something real. Miss Michelle Bryan is not with us, and so Keith Barris is sitting in for today. We're going to take a quick break. Call, I see you. I'm going to grab you right after the break. We'll be right back.
For an Allstate agent, providing protection options that fit your life is something that they take well. Personally, Allstate agents are committed to learning about your needs and helping customize protection to meet them. From bundling your home and auto insurance with ease to evaluating optional coverage, your Allstate agent can help build an insurance proposal that fits your life. And just as important as learning what you need is learning what you don't. Because helping you get the coverage you want with the savings you deserve is what Allstate is all about. It's time to get coverage that's catered to you. Are you in good hands? Call Milwaukee Allstate agent Cindy Johnson at 414-445-2558. That's 414-445-2558. Today, for a free quote, home, auto, renters, condo, and more. Sydney, Nancy, and Lyndon can't wait to meet you.
Subject to terms and conditions and availability. Allstate Fire and Casualty Insurance Company and Allstate Property and Casualty Insurance Company and its affiliates, Northbrook, Illinois.
The Center for Teaching Entrepreneurship presents its third annual Big Head Soiree Thursday, May 16th at the Marcus Performing Arts Center in the Bradley Pavilion. I'm Andrea Williams, and I'll be your host for this spectacular event. It's designed to salute the co-founder, Miss Radonna Rogers, as she loved to wear big hats, and this is one way we honor her. We will also celebrate and recognize the accomplishments of Milwaukee's leaders in entrepreneurial ventures.
TTE was founded with the mission in mind to help young people understand understand business, financial literacy, and themselves, and how they can find their way into the marketplace and be productive citizens. We have found a great way to educate, stimulate, and advance what we're doing within this community.
So, ladies, this is the time to wear your big hat, and guys, your stylish fedora. You will be treated to a delectable dinner and the sounds of Soul Sirius starting at 5:30. The program will begin at 7 with more entertainment and the awards program. Tickets are just $75. Go to Eventbrite using VHS24 or call 414-788-8104. That's 414-788-8104. This event will kick off the spring season, so don't miss it.
This event is sponsored by Wisconsin Black Chamber of Commerce, U.S. Bank, Brewers Community Foundation, and BizStart.
Black history is something to appreciate, celebrate, and participate. Play Ode is a mobile app that streams America's best Black-owned radio stations and podcasts from across the country. ODE stands for Our Digital Entertainment. Play Ode features music and entertainment for us and by us. Listen to WNOV The Voice Milwaukee on the Play Ode app. Elevate your radio listening and participate in supporting Black radio. Download PLAYODE or log onto odeaudio.com for info and insight.
Milwaukee. We are about to enter one of the most important election seasons of our lives. 2024 is going to be pivotal. Here at WNOV, we work to ensure that our listeners are informed, knowledgeable, and engaged. On Tuesday, April 2nd, tune in from 3 to 8 p.m. for another edition of Election Central. Hear from candidates, discuss ballot referendums, and get real-time election updates and report problems throughout the course of the day. We are ready, and you should be too. Election Central on WNOV 860 AM 106.5 FM, sponsored by Souls to the Pulse.
WNOV 860 and W293 CX 106.5 Milwaukee.
1, 2, testing 1, 2. All right, party people in the place to be. The party has already started.
And I got all my sisters the men. And I'm positive time. Oh, this is ladies night. Oh, what a fool.
Ain't no ladies in here today, though.
All fellas, Doc.
Yeah, but still a great bass line.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Good tune.
Boy, you musicians, man, where would we be?
Man. Yeah, tell me about it, man. We enjoy.
And, you know, we were just talking about some of the, you know, some of the greats, but I don't know how we didn't mention Pastor Valerie Daniels Carter.
Oh, yeah.
One of the greatest directors.
Now, she can play, too. Now, listen, people sleeping on her. She can play.
Yeah.
I remember one time. I'll never forget it. She kicked me off the organ one time, but I deserved it.
Wait.
Listen here, man.
What was you doing?
It's the most funniest story of my life. You ever saw the movie Friday?
Yeah. Of course.
All right. Remember Big Worm?
Mm-hmm.
I was in the truck. Mm-hmm. I showed up at a Koja convention.
Oh, Lord.
With my hair like Big Worm.
Oh, boy.
And got on the org. It was the funniest thing in the world. Because it seemed like they just took the hot press things out of my. So it was still smoking. Right. I'm not right handed guy, dude. I can call her right now and she would say. I got on the organ.
I'm here. Yeah, we can start.
I got the
plan.
Listen, Val walked, or Sister Carter walked up behind me, tapped me on the shoulder. Uh-uh. Jeff, don't you ever come in here looking like that ever again.
She called Jeff.
Jeff. Jeff looked at me and fell out. I was like, because I just saw the movie Friday, so I'm like, let me. Well, my hair was on fire. I mean, it was still smoking from the iron. I got on that joint, boy.
Messing with her feelings.
Boy, she looked at me. Her eyes got big. Like, what is this jump?
And she know you know better.
Hey, in front of all, listen, it was so many people out there.
I could imagine.
I'm playing. I get ready to start.
A convention?
Yes, a Koji convention. So you know the Church of God in Christ, they stick on everything. So I come in there looking like I'm off second to Taliban with rollers, just took it out of my hair. Boy, she tapped me so hard on the shoulder. Right out. Don't you ever come in here looking like that ever again.
You done lost it.
Playing me. Yeah, like they playing his butt off.
She hit me on the shoulder so hard.
Jeff, which Jeff does she call?
Tucker.
Jeff Tucker. Yeah.
Rest in peace, Jeff. But
yeah.
Yeah.
He's another. He was good, too.
Oh, he was the truth. Man, yes, I got sir. A lot of my feels from him.
You know what's interesting? And they had moved into the new sanctuary, yet they were still in the they were in the building.
Jeffrey
Conference Center. That's what it is now. Right. Yeah. But it was the original church.
And they had an anniversary. And they decided to have DeMonte
Posey
as their Holy Redeemer is already here.
Right.
With him playing, they went to a level I was like, and it says a whole lot. He's just a genius. There is no question, man. I mean, because he did a couple of songs for Eric Benet.
He did some joints for Eric Benet.
He worked with Mary too, didn't he?
He worked with Mary. He worked with Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Okay.
He actually did the movie score for the movie, the New Edition movie.
Oh, okay.
So he did the score for that. So he got a lot under his belt.
Another cat that doesn't get a lot of recognition, he's currently doing a residence out in Vegas, is Tyree.
Oh, yeah.
Boggy guy came from us and then got to West Side. I know Steve. Reggie Royal. Reggie has a very interesting story. Grew up Baptist.
Mm-hmm.
Got saved to the Church of God in Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Studied religion. And now he's a Muslim.
That cat is one of the craziest organists.
Dude, you just...
Reggie Royal is unbelievable.
I was watching a videotape of Bishop Blake's church, West Angeles.
Yeah.
And they had this... she's their guest soloist, and she's an opera singer.
Mm-hmm.
I'm looking up by the keyboards. Is this dude playing with his briefcase? Like, who? That dude looked familiar. It was Abid.
Oh, wow.
And he played, it was just amazing. He to grow up with him, and we knew, well, here's the thing about him that was so fascinating. We had the music, but because we're a family, we're a choir, we also have relationships.
Mm-hmm.
And he certainly is one of the brightest people ever. I mean, if I talk to him now, we'll talk for 2.5 hours about everything.
Yeah. I think we forgot we got that call.
Oh, we sure did. I'm
let's go ahead and get the call.
Welcome to the program.
Good morning, and thank you so much for reminiscing about our church days way back in the day.
Yes,
when
ma'am.
I was in Greater Galilee, and we had this training union, and where it taught you the mannerisms, how to conduct yourself in a church service.
Mm-hmm.
And I met some amazing families and people that have poured into you, and that stays with you. Like you were talking about the community choir, and there were the harmonics and the voices of, it was Galilee then, and we followed them.
Oh, yeah, the voices, yeah.
And the harmonics around.
Because a lot of the people in the harmonics came from Galilee, right?
Yeah, they did come from Galilee, and they bled into the community choir. And I'm telling you, like you said, they come in the door ready to sing.
Mm-hmm.
And let us not forget the Prestonians. We cannot forget the Prestonians.
And right, it's just so many. And I'm going to tell you another thing. Growing up in the church way back then, we would go on weekend trips and sing in other churches. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
These kids aren't getting nothing that we used to have, okay?
That's true.
And it was fun going to church. And I'm going to tell you something. When God give you a gift, there was a guy, Arnett Shaw.
Oh, yeah.
You talk about to make a piano talk. As if it is the soloist saying the word, and he did not read notes, okay? So when Professor Hall, and then I'm going to tell you another thing.
Professor Hall.
Yeah. My seventh, eighth, and ninth grade. No, I had Miss Murphy, my ninth grade.
Miss Murphy, yeah.
Who was over at Galilee, but I also had Mr. Hall. Oh, that dude. Ooh. I'd never been cussed out by a teacher until this dude cussed us out. Then when we go over to Galilee, who we see? Professor Hall.
Yeah.
Right.
Always looked like he was pregnant.
We used to have people confided that we would sing And I mean, it had to be to perfection because he loved music. Mm-hmm. So this is what he was saying. He read notes, Arnett did not. And then it was some other people that go off to this school where this is, I can't think of the name of. But anyway, he just, in amazement, said he played more chords than anybody I ever known. So then he taught him how to read notes. He said, this takes too much time. Mm-hmm. Because it was a gift. My brother and I took piano lessons. And the kids that were before us were excellent. So he would always go in there first. He played by ear, mm-hmm. not by the notes. And she was just so happy with him. And then when I come in, hit the wrong note, she hit me with that ruler. And I was like, you know something? He don't even know the notes. I do, so I goofed up. And she said, stop. This is when I learned. Do what you do and don't put nobody else down. Improve your game. Mm-hmm. But anyway,
so you didn't know that a ruler was used for measurement, huh?
Oh, you know, okay, right. And I said, right, and told my mother, she said, I'm not paying you to go get a beat. You learn those chords. I said, Michael don't know an accent.
Well, you know, it's interesting that, you know, we're talking about singing in the choir, and we sang from Friday to Sunday, sometimes twice on Sunday. Mm-hmm. Wow. We found ourselves in some churches, especially on Friday nights. You know, Friday nights, you just...
I'll tell you somebody we didn't mention.
Yeah, now from West Side.
That had a bad choir.
Who?
St. John's.
St. John's, thank you.
St. Yeah.
And they were little.
Brenda.
Yeah. Well, she... Yeah. And she can preach.
And I just want to mention
Brenda Kearney can preach.
Go ahead. Yeah.
Okay, now, you know, West Side was up on 26th and Hour. Mm-hmm. That right. was the gallery. And Christian Faith, what? I can't even, come on now, I'm really getting too old to get.
Daryl Hines?
It was Daryl Hines and his sister Phoebe.
Uh-huh.
We would be up there on Friday. Now, this is when the neighborhood was safe.
Right.
We could be up there, and it started 7 o'clock, and sometimes we would leave there till 12 because they would be recording. It was church. I'm telling you, we had a ball. My parents didn't believe we were up there that late. They came up there to see what was going on. You could mm-hmm. hear all the outside of the church.
Yeah, you know, things have certainly changed. And I to me, I think a big part of it is church is not as prevalent or, right. you know, in our lives as it once was. I hear people talk about the civil rights movement and how engaged the church was and what a pivotal part it played in that. And it just doesn't seem that same engagement is there from a community standpoint when it comes down to our churches.
It's because, remember, you know, we were brought up real quick. If you got pregnant, you were ostracized. It was an embarrassment. You had to go before the church and apologize and all this here kind of stuff.
Thank God we don't do that. Man.
And mother started putting, you know, saying, I'm not going to help you. So then it just went down with that young lady struggling with her kids. And they lost sight of church. So you got three generations that know nothing about Adam and Eve
mm-hmm.
because they don't go. But now we have to get them roped back in. And we have to keep bringing this up and keep working together because there is something great in us. And we need to awaken that in our young people and not with the negative stuff thinking they're not going to live. And then I'm going to tell you another thing with Easter. I like the seven last words when the church would get together and they would combine churches.
Oh, God. Yeah, Jesus gonna take a killing on Friday.
Man, listen here.
They gonna kill Jesus at least seven times on Friday.
Man, listen. I hate.
What?
I hate going to them services. Because I'm gonna tell you why. Wait, just leave me out. Because I'm gonna tell you why. Me as a musician, right? The service will start at 9 o'clock or 10 o'clock, and we won't get out of there till like 3-4 o'clock. In the afternoon.
You used to that at Rehoboth.
But I can't. Listen, it don't take all day for Jesus to say seven words.
I know, but it was, you didn't even realize it. And I'm going to tell you another thing.
Yes, you did. Yes, you did. Depending on the preacher.
Because, doctor, you stood up and your leg gave out. So do you realize?
Yeah, here you got seven preachers, and I didn't come to out-preach my brethren, but I'm going to out-preach my brethren.
Man.
Yeah. Yeah, or sister, because we have sisters.
And I get it what Jermaine's saying as a musician, because sometimes, you know, I play drums coming up in the church, so it's like, especially when they get one of them long shouting sessions,
and
you wore out, man.
I think they call them praise breaks.
Praise breaks.
They didn't take no breaks then. They praised for a while.
Man, I didn't kick people off the drums because they...
They were dragging.
Oh, my God.
Couldn't keep tempo.
Get off. I kicked the guy off middle of the service, right in the middle of the service.
I'm going to call a name. I'm going to see if y'all remember. Johnny Yule.
Oh yeah,
that name
that great nice. Singer. Yeah, he was a bus driver by trade. Right, Johnny Yule.
That name.
Oh yeah. What about Willie Mae? Willie Mae Fletcher that was down at Friendship.
Nah, see, I didn't know about Willie Mae.
You know, Willie Mae was our Baptist equivalent to your Jesse Folks.
Oh, I was about to say Jesse. Now,
Jesse
Folks.
Was incredible. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean that.
Is Jesse still alive?
No.
No, he passed away.
No, Jesse's a lady.
No, I think Jesse passed away.
Yeah, she did.
That's
yeah.
Michael Folks.
Michael Folks. Yeah. Michael plays, right?
Right, right. Right. Yeah. Right.
Oh, and I want to say one other thing before we get off. Over by Holy Redeemer, their 12 o'clock service is going to have men praying.
Right. I heard so Valerie talking about that. Pastor got so Valerie.
If people don't have nowhere to go, go to these churches, take your kids so that they can at least get something. I mean, just hear people and give it a chance.
But you know,
you've been in this all this time. Give God a chance. And thank you so much for bringing this all up and reminiscing.
But yeah, I think the difference was when these kids just have more social outlets than we did.
Yeah.
And I could have been a far better basketball player if I would have devoted as much time to that as I did as a teenager wanting to sing. Mm-hmm. You know, the irony was that the year we won the state championship, we're downtown. It was also my choir's anniversary weekend. Boy. And for us, choir anniversary. Well, I got there for Saturday night, but we played Sunday afternoon. And I remember coming to church and my buddy said, man, you need to go out with them. And Mr. Jones threw us a party that is legendary. But yeah, it was always conflicted, man. I'm gonna be honest with you. What attracted me to the choir was not what kept me there. Right. And I was attracted to the choir because it was a young lady I liked. But then I got there and really discovered how much I love music. Mm-hmm. And to be around people who were creating beautiful music or to hear that, it was just, and I still had this great love, you know, for church music, choir mm-hmm. music, now the quartets.
Well, see, that was a great era then because you're talking about the Winans yeah. when they came out yeah. And commission. Yeah.
Minister White. Yeah, you had the Winans, you had Commission, you even had female groups like True Flats.
But the music was changing then.
Yeah, yeah.
And it had gotten away from the Shirley Caesars and the Keith Pringles and the James Clevelands, and it was going
Keith Pringle wrote
direction.
Some good music, though.
He did.
Good music.
Walter Hawkins.
Walter Hawkins. See, yeah, but the music, Jermaine. it was changing over because in that 80s, the late 80s, early 90s is when you had that feel of I don't want to say funk, but it was more of the gospel music was changing over.
Well, it was
to,
at that time
to
what
would the
call
style
it
was. Yeah, to what the style was. So you had a lot of that feel that, because I was listening to a Winans joint, Let My People Go, right?
Oh, yeah.
And if you listen to that joint, the music actually came from... what's that? I play it too, and I can't think of the cat name.
Let me say this,
because Teddy Riley, it's
Teddy
time.
Riley. Yeah.
He did. He produced this time.
Yeah, time to make a change.
He did.
Yeah, that's
yeah.
Teddy Riley.
We are the people who can do. Yeah.
Well, how about this for the kind of you were going this thing? There was a song I was listening to. R. Kelly wrote some great religious music.
He
if
sure
you ever
did.
Get a chance, he got some good stuff, right? And he wrote a song, and Marvin Sapp sang it, mm-hmm. and that's when everything jumped, right? So they asked Marvin Sapp, they said, well, did you? Yeah, man, I didn't know. How could you not know, man? How could you not know?
He had a hit, though.
Yeah, he had a hit. Well, you know, let me, I had a conversation with Bishop Hines, and I just went on and on about how great a songwriter he was. He said that one of the great regrets he had was that he never formally studied music. He says, now you go in and play the computer, we'll give you your notes, and they'll do all the, you know, everything you need. Uh-huh. And I said, excuse me, bro. Now, I know y'all wasn't allowed to listen to secular music, mm-hmm. but I heard a little something, so I want to know how you got that little something.
Right.
Now, the Clark sisters told the story because that they would go by their friend's house because
yeah.
their mm-hmm. mama wasn't letting them come in the house.
Right.
And they would say, open the window, and then they would listen. So she must have heard Master Blaster.
Yeah, that's how she got that hit.
Yeah. Yeah, and you know what? And he let her use it. It's basically his song.
Yeah. That's how Stevie. So, I mean, but they've been getting on us like, y'all playing worldly music in the church. Hold up. First of all, music really is innocent. Right. Music is innocent until you put the words to it.
It don't have a religion.
It don't have, it's just
a denomination. None
music.
Of that.
Did y'all know that the Baptist folks did not want them playing Precious Lord in the church? That was too bluesy.
Man, they didn't want drums.
Oh, don't even tell me about my story with
that. As a vocalist, the hardest, now listen, I'm just going to put this out here. As a vocalist, you kind of gauge the reaction of the people is, did I do good? You know, people say, man, you saw that, man. I told the church up. I told the church up. I could never get a Baptist church to tear. I couldn't tear the Baptist church up.
Man, because they'll just sit there and look at
you. Because you ain't tearing up our churches.
There ain't going to be no buck jumping.
We ain't taking nobody out this building for it. Ain't nobody come out this building for it in 8 years. And here you coming up in here tearing up our carpet.
Because when we were talking about the Whiners, man, that one song to me is when the whole gospel music changed. The question is.
Oh, my God. Yeah. Oh, yeah. That changed the whole dynamic of everything.
You don't think it was Oh Happy Day?
Mm-mm. No. Oh Happy Day
was still in that vein.
Yeah, it was still in that old 70s.
When Jesus was.
But then when the beat changed, that's when they started saying, oh, it's worldly. Okay. But in reality, it was really keeping up with the times. It's with the times, because if you right now create some music that sound like the 60s, they gonna say, man, that sound like the 60s.
But you know what,
sound like the 50s.
What you had there, though, was a class condescension, I'm using this term, that Baptist folks look down on Pentecostal folks.
Sure, yeah, and we vice versa.
Yeah, because y'all was saved.
Yeah.
No, wait.
Because they used to say, Church of God in Christ folks, wait and get in their car and smoke.
Yeah, Baptist they said Baptist folks go right outside
the door. Right on the parking lot.
Yeah, but there were some churches I visited that had a smoking room.
Listen,
that were Baptists.
I played at this one church, I ain't gonna say the name of it, but I played, and when you go in the basement, they had a smoking section.
Right. Yeah.
So that was new to me. I'm like, huh? Like, where they do that at? I guess here.
And hard as I tried, I just couldn't get saved like y'all talked about getting saved.
Y'all gave up too much.
Saved, sanctified, God ain't through with yet. He's still working on me.
Baptized, running on with my life. It's like, God, dog, it's too long.
That's a lot.
I'm tired after saying all
that. And Lord, oh my God, ain't nothing like Church of God in Christ testimony service.
Man, I'm going to tell you, the church that I've been attending, I haven't been in a little while now, but my wife and I went, and we're sitting there. We start at 9, and we're out by 10:30. So I'm like, what am I supposed to do with the rest of my day? I don't know. But no, watch this. The choir sang 3-4 songs. Uh-huh. They raised the offering. Preached a nice sermon. It, you know, wasn't short of nothing. And we still out by 10:30.
But this is the question, though.
And not that anything's wrong with it, but it made me wonder. I'm like, other than testimony service, they did everything that we was doing back then. Why did it take us till 3:30, 4 o'clock to get out?
Well, a lot of that was, you had a lot of people that got up and talked and just told their whole life.
No, wait.
Jermaine. Like they hurt their toe on Tuesday.
I paid my light bill on Friday. And this morning when I got up, I went over to hit the lights, and the lights came on. Lord, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Yeah, you paid your bill, brother. That's why you like that.
You know what? I know why that's a testimony.
Why?
My mama said this to me. I marveled at how my mama made it work.
Uh-huh.
And my mama admitted something to me many, many years. She said there were some days I didn't know if I was going to have gas to get to work.
Uh-huh.
So the Lord made a way. And so I understand that testimony.
Not about the light switch, though.
Oh, well, you know,
we paid your bill.
And listen, this is the other thing, y'all. Microphone is like crack.
Yeah.
Yeah.
People get up with the microphone and it turns them into, that's why I hate open mic at funerals. I call it what it is. It's not 2 minutes of expressions of friends and family. Open mic. It's open mic.
Listen here, man. I've seen some. Listen, I got contracts with funeral homes.
Yeah, I know you play them.
So,
oh, you're the house musician?
Listen, I've seen some stuff, Doc, that will. Man, listen here. I mean, I fell off the organ one time. This one guy got up and got to talking and told the whole business. And I guess the guy that was dead, his mistress was dead.
Uh-oh.
What role was she in?
Wow.
What role?
And the wife was dead.
Ooh. Wow.
And Doc, when I tell you, after they carried him out, oh, they was rumbling. They was, because the chick that showed up, I probably shouldn't say that because
they might be. Or somebody that know him might be.
Right. Was like, I remember that. I was there.
Julius Rumor on the radio.
I was there. I seen it.
Gotta be Julius.
Lizzie and Doc, you talking about rolling. I fell off the organ like this cat here, boy, told everything. Spilled the beans.
I was at a neighborhood funeral. I call it a neighborhood funeral because the people from the neighborhood knew this guy. This was mm-hmm. So he came. I'm at this neighborhood funeral. They don't go to church.
Right.
So me and pastor sitting in the pulpit and people getting up talking. And then this brother, and excuse me, I think I'm okay because I'm doing a quote. Hopefully FCC won't. So he get up. He go, yeah, man. We in church. Uh-huh. He go, yeah, man. Dre didn't take no shit. And me and pastor looked at each
alligator other. Alligator don't take no look.
We looked at each other and we said, okay, let's not say anything.
Alligator don't take no.
This is a neighborhood.
He might not either.
Right. Like, we looked at each other like, okay. And you know, normally people get up because I, you know, sometimes pastors get up and they want to correct. We just went, let's just act like it didn't happen.
Right,
and we'll just keep it moving.
Well, what about when the pastor accidentally cussed?
Doc, I seen. Listen, I seen that too. I got some stories to tell.
I got a class. I had a classmate, Roger Lawton, and Roger Lawton was a pastor of the church. And Lawton got up on Sunday morning. This dude could preach. Cussed out the whole church Sunday morning from the pulpit.
Doc, wow. I'd have fell off the organ. I'd have played Looney Tune music on the organ while he was going,
and then didn't even ask the guests to leave.
Hey, got some housekeeping to do.
He was in his feeling. He felt it.
We'll listen to Chameleon Boys Call. I'm going to grab you right after the break. We'll be right back.
I'm Mr. Debo, the program director here at the all-new 860 WNOV. On January 8th of this year, WNOV underwent a relaunch, complete with a fresh logo, branding, format, and new shows. Now you can even stream our talk shows on YouTube and Facebook. We're always striving to enhance your listening experience, and now your watching experience too. As we continue to work on improving, there may be more changes in our lineup. Here's a few of the changes we've made. We've added Sandra Silk and All That Jazz on Tuesdays and Thursdays. Chris Heavy Levy on Saturdays with Saturday Backtracks and more. Flavor Fix with foodie Samantha Starr. How about Pillow Talk with me, Mr. Debo, on the porch with Kwai, with Kwabenon Anton Nixon. The Difference with Will Martin. Be a Voice with Wisconsin Voices, Dr. Kwaku and Nyumbo Mpendo. Money Talks with attorney Carl Plez. Brought to you by Columbia Savings and Loan. The Friday Night Jukebox Party with DJ Kevin Buchanan. St. Mark's Lutheran Church with Pastor Marty from 9 a.m. until 9:30 a.m. Community Outreach Clinics, Community Heartbeat, with more to come. But rest assured, of course, we have our staple shows that have not changed and will not change. Say Something Real with Michelle Bryant. Community Voice with Keith Paris. International Roots Rock Reggae Meltdown with Ross Joel. The Blues Cafe with me, Mr. Debo. Reverend Al Sharpton from 12 until 3. We're listening to you, and we'll get it right together. And thank you for listening to the all-new 860 WNOV and 106.5 FM, The Voice.
On April 2nd, Milwaukee Public Schools is asking you to vote for a permanent 30% property tax increase. At a time when Milwaukee families are feeling the pinch financially, it's the wrong time for a tax increase. Students and families deserve accountability. We need a comprehensive plan from MPS with real solutions, not just a new tax. Vote no to 30% on April 2nd. Paid for by CFC Action Fund as an in-kind contribution to
Carter's Creations, when quality and service matters for any occasion. Sometimes you just want to send a floral arrangement for a get well, anniversary, birthday, or I messed up, or just because. Carter's Creations at 1727 West Hampton Avenue is the place you need to call. So call them today at 414-265-1727 or visit them online at carterscreations.com. Carter's Creations has been in business for over 30 years. Therefore, you know they know what they're doing. They also specialize in funerals as well. So when you need that special floral arrangement, think of Carter's Creations, when quality and service matter.
The Trump economy was a disaster for Black America. He prioritized the wealthy and big business, not us, giving them tax breaks while we got left behind. Under Trump, hundreds of thousands of Black Americans lost health insurance in the middle of a pandemic. And don't forget the division, the violence, and disrespect we faced while he was in charge. Now, he's coming after our voting rights. And if he's president again, Trump vowed to be a, quote, dictator who would get revenge. We can't go back. President Joe Biden and Vice President Kamala Harris are working hard for Black America. They sent $1,400 cash relief checks when they were needed most. Our wages are up. We've got millions of new good-paying jobs. And the cost of insulin is capped at $35 for seniors. There's more to do, but it's clear that on the economy, Black America is getting ahead with President Joe Biden and Vice President Kamala Harris.
I'm Joe Biden, candidate for president, and I approve this message.
Paid for by Biden for President.
WNOV 860 and W293CX 106.5 Milwaukee.
I was welcome back, and so I'd say something real. I was just sitting up there listening. I don't know who the genius was that started scratching. Yeah. And that little bit to music, you know, because you back in the day on vinyl, you had to be very careful because one little scratch on that, this skipping, but that whole who came up with the idea of just scratching in a song, you go like, wow. So whoever that brother is, shout out to you for giving such a positive contribution to music. Caller, welcome to the program. Good morning.
Good morning. How are you, Keith?
Good morning. How are you?
And all of my beautiful Black brothers up in the studio. I was laughing so hard. I was crying. Y'all got me crying. I'm in the kitchen. And I got my coffee. Okay. I'm okay now.
Okay.
As far as testimony service, the deacon at my church, Union Hill Missionary Baptist Church, I'm going to go and give the address out while I'm at it, 2190 North 49th Street in the great city of Milwaukee.
You advertising your church right now?
No, I'm just giving you that.
That little shameless plug, wasn't it, Keith?
Where do you go to church? Right. And where is it located?
Shameless plug.
I would tell you, it is a historical landmark.
It is.
And they used to, it was owned by Catholics, and they used to have bingo down there and all that. We had removed all the bars and everything, you know. So what I was going to tell you is that, you know, when you do the testimony, the deacon was standing right by you. Make sure you didn't talk too long.
They had it figured out. Right. We didn't have it figured out over there by us.
Oh, yeah. And so we
One minute.
Okay.
So, I'm trying to get on and watch the Packer game.
Okay.
Listen here, boy.
Me too, because I'm a walking tag.
Well, you know what? We had a young man in our choir. He loved to shout. Oh, he tapped the church.
That's another thing that would make the service long.
Right. And so now look, we used to go down to Emmanuel Baptist Church in Beloit, Wisconsin, and the late Pastor Prude. And so we go down for revival, and it was the late Dennis J. Ward, great preacher. So we're down. So my boy get up, and he starts shouting. Oh, he just, can't nobody do anything with him. Well, down there, Emmanuel, they had an usher who was as tall as he was wide. We called him Big Boy. So Big Boy started making his way to the choir stand. All those other ushers couldn't do nothing. Big Boy put him in a bear hug, and boy fainted.
Took all his breath away.
Because, you know, and look, again, I didn't grow up in the Church of God in Christ, but I spent a whole lot of time in the Church of God in Christ.
Right.
At Pentecostal church and apostolic churches. Let me tell you something. You got to figure out how to end your shout. I figured that one out. You got to figure it out.
Put the camera in, man. How you in it?
Because you exhausted.
You got to figure it out.
You
got to figure it out. Like, okay, hold on.
I ain't got nothing left.
Got to end that thing. Somewhat.
Wait, what are you saying, Carla? We can barely hear you.
Did you ever go and hear, any of you have ever heard the sermon, the eagle stirs, and that.
C.L. Franklin.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. I, you know, that sermon, I haven't heard it yet, but I'm going to download that because that is something.
I got it on my phone.
Now, that particular sermon, in watching some of the documentaries, I've heard that kind of changed and defined, if you will, him and preaching with the, because that was like the beginning of the hooping, wasn't it?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. But, you know, black preachers have been hooping and doing call and response since enslavement.
Yeah, but this
he took it to a level that is, in terms of black preaching, I'm talking about this art form of black preaching. And not only could he had a great tune, he could squawk. He could, and we call it
the business. We talking about Rita Daddy.
Yeah. And you can hear her do it.
Yeah. Let me encourage you to go on YouTube, and now I know there was a movie with I don't know what movie it was, The Godfather with Forrest Whitaker. I encourage you to listen to Jennifer Hudson imitate Aretha. She's singing Amazing Grace. I tell you, Keith, Evo and the young man, it will chill your soul. It will bring it, you know, it'll go way down deep in your soul, your sanctified soul. But let me tell you, brother, I am a blood wash believer.
Here come this morning. I knew it was coming this morning.
See, I'll come up there and take all of y'all.
Yeah. You're going to make me tune up.
Because he delivered Gilligan.
And I'm going to go with you. And one of these days.
Gilligan. You know, I love to see
Gilligan ever get off the island.
No, I don't think Gilligan ever got off. He never got, but I love to hear Tamla Mann's husband when he do a choir director.
You know, we know somebody just like him. It was at everybody's church.
Oh my God!
You know who I used to love to hear sing? Remember how Mother Jewel used to sing?
Oh, Mother Jewel, yeah.
How did she sound, man?
She had a sweet voice, though. It was like, you know, it was soft, but it had that shakiness.
That shakiness.
Yeah, though she had that that Billy Gold
vibrato.
Billy Golditis.
I don't know.
This wasn't Billy Golditis.
Billy Golditis, not shaking baby syndrome.
I don't know how I got to follow Mother Hines.
Oh, Corinna Hines.
Thomas Watley's funeral.
I
had to get up behind her.
Yeah, Thomas Watley.
And with the Philadelphia.
Oh, yeah. Jerry Curl. What did you do?
Yeah.
What was that? Was that just his good hair?
No, that was his hair.
That's his hair. Yeah, Thomas grew up Catholic. We met Thomas. We had a revival at Metropolitan. I was 14. Thomas would have been 16. We had a revival, St. Elizabeth's, because at that point, Catholic churches had great gospel choirs.
Yeah.
Right. And St. Elizabeth had a little, so we invited them over. Thomas came over, fell in love with us. And for 2 years, he sang in the choir. He did all that. But his mother would not let him join because he was Catholic. Mm-hmm. So as soon as Thomas turned 18, he got baptized. But I don't know why I got to follow her at his funeral. Because that woman,
she could tell the church
sure enough could sing.
Oh, yeah.
And Phoebe was good, but Phoebe wasn't her mama.
No,
that woman. Oh, Lord.
Yeah. We're talking about singing with an anointing.
Oh, my God.
She could do it.
That's it.
Well, now don't leave Governor Harris out, her brother.
Oh, Governor Harris, yeah.
Man, he could tear up a church, too.
Yeah.
Well, and that because the West Side was the Harris family.
Harris, Hines.
Pattersons.
Well, the Pattersons were in there, but the Stokes in there, too?
Yeah, and then, of course, the Daniels.
Yeah.
Hey, Keith, I really, truly want y'all to listen to Jennifer. I really want y'all to pull her up on YouTube. She sings Amazing Grace that's going to really do, and some of her other songs, God Promised Me.
But you know what's amazing? Lady, what is the greatest selling live gospel recording of all time?
Oh, my God.
Greatest selling live gospel recording of all time.
Amazing Grace.
You listen to Robert
Aretha Franklin.
And
Aretha Franklin, Amazing Grace. And here's what's amazing about Amazing Grace.
That's amazing to me because it looks like James Cleveland because he did a lot of live stuff.
No, that album today is still considered because it's still selling, certainly after the movie. Martin Scorsese comes out and he does that whole documentary.
Mm-hmm.
Here's what's amazing. Geez. Anybody has ever been to a live recording, know they stop. They only stop once. And it wasn't even the middle of the song. They kind of had their timing off. James Cleveland stopped it. And then they did it all one take. That doesn't happen. That shows you how good the Southern California Community Choir was and the brother they had coming in directing them. And then how good Aretha Franklin was.
Yes, and he's imitating Aretha Franklin in the church. You know, that's what, what is her name? Come on now.
Jennifer.
She got some pipes.
Well, she puts me in the mind of Aretha anyway, as far as style.
Exactly
another
what I'm talking,
another one that, I'm that also puts me in the mind of Aretha. And I always said from the first day I heard her release after, you know, American Idol or what have you, would have been a Fantasia. Just an awesome range and so forth and so on.
She got something.
That's my girl right there. I love Fantasia. Factor, Jennifer's okay. You know, she's an EGOT. She's what they call an EGOT because she got the Emmy, the Grammy, the
and she's
Oscar,
a
the
better
Tony.
Singer than Fantasia, but Fantasia brings something to her singing. There is.
I don't know that she's better than Fantasia.
Wait, who did you say that was a better singer?
Jennifer's not a better singer than Fantasia.
She's
not a
better. You don't think so?
She's not a better singer. No, she can sing. The difference between her and Fantasia, there's really levels to singing.
Okay.
Some people, some people they can get, you know, high to the plateau. The difference between Fantasia, she can tap into something else that'll take you on a whole nother journey. So it's like when you hear her. Some people have the gift. Some people have the gift and the anointing.
Charisma.
So you don't have to be living the life, the godly life, to even have that gift or the anointing, because gifts come without repentance. So you can have an extreme gift. Some people's gifted and talented. And that's
I watch a Fantasia take that stage.
Yeah,
and take them shoes off.
Yeah,
and say we getting ready to get busy.
Yeah, and just go.
That's one of the best shows I ever went to.
Fantasia,
When
she was here.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Incredible.
Yeah. Now during COVID, we're Facebook friends, so I followed her, and it would pop up all the time. And she was just everyday people, just like you and me. And she would sing a little bit on her little live or whatever, and she would, you know, she just impressed me as an individual.
Yeah.
She's been through as well, I mean, you know, when she came out, she couldn't read and all of this stuff, man, and you know, just how life changes and how good God can be, how good he is.
Thank you, Carla. I don't differentiate between gospel. If you're getting paid, you're a professional. I'm just going to say that, right? So if folks are out there, these folks are, and you know, if you get behind the scenes, you find out, because who just hollered on how crazy gospel artist was behind the stage? She just hollered on him. What's her name? Kelly Price.
Kelly. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
But that.
Yeah. And then there's a lot going on. But I'm just saying, look, they
recently got in the game. She ain't got no business. Yeah. Telling no business now.
Yeah, that's
man. But yeah, if you go behind the stage, no, the folks are not what you see on stage. They become very human off stage. I think the Clark Sisters had a song about I want my life to reflect. Is my living in vain.
Is my living in vain.
Right. And how, but the reality is these are human beings. Absolutely.
And too, man, I want to say this. This is what people have to understand. We all fall short. There's no perfect person that walks this earth. So being a preacher, being a pastor, being a bishop is just a title. Mm-hmm. That's a title that you carry, just like program director, but you still human after the program director. And after the host. So what I'm trying to say is this. We all are subject
to... with this?
See, follow me, Doc. I'm about to tune up in here.
Show us what a culture too.
We all subject to this thing. It's offering time now.
You mean offering already?
That's it, Doc. He just said, show me how the coach do it. I just took, man. Yes, now that would be a $50 line, a $1,000 line.
At C.L. Franklin's funeral, Jasper Williams got up.
Woo! That cat can go too.
Jasper got up and Jasper just squalled. And Jasper sat down.
Yeah, he can go, Doc.
And those preachers said, get back up.
That cat can go.
I'm going to tell you, if you, it's nothing like, and you notice either performing in front of your peers, I always give the analogy, if you're a fish and a bird comes by and says, you're a great swimmer, it doesn't mean as much as another fish coming by saying, you're a great fish.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And because they know what it is to be a fish.
I like that.
And game recognized game.
I like that.
And so when you see talent out there, that's why I said, like, I watched the Grammys and watched those country dudes getting down with the rappers, then watch the rappers getting down with country dudes. Because music is just music.
Yeah.
Right. Good music is good music. Yeah. In America, we racialize everything. But the reality is that there's some things that are so universal that you wouldn't. Stax Records brought in three sisters. Mm-hmm. They did the background vocals. So some of these songs you hear these sisters singing in the background, you thinking they sisters. Three white girls. Three white girls. I mean, you and so I think we have a tendency to again try to racialize it and the whole thing. But I like good music, man. I will go and watch or listen to the Milwaukee Symphony because I love symphonic music.
And I thought you were going somewhere with it. I thought you were saying, and I guess you did in your own way. But yeah, I marvel at how preachers interact with one another. And you know, when that preacher is really getting down, you can tell that he's getting down by the reaction of the other preachers. Because they're going to get up and get behind him. They're going to support
him. Or they won't.
And if they don't, that they just hating.
Sometimes you just die. Okay. Sometimes you just die. I mean, you can get up, and that's a lot of pressure preaching in front of your peers. You know, the folks out in the congregation might not know how the sausage is made.
Mm-hmm.
All those preachers know. The joke the comedian told, he said, you know, when you go to your mama's funeral and all those preachers sitting back there saying, I should have been doing the eulogy. And I've been there when it's been packed with preachers. And guys who you normally would not say, you preach your greatest sermon then, you know, because the one thing you never want to do, I shouldn't be doing so much inside baseball, you don't want to die in front of your peers. What does that mean? Like you were talking about, I'm not saying you died, but you can't tear up a church.
Yeah,
sometimes you can die. I mean, people sitting out there going like, oh, dude,
this is not good.
Dude, we had a student at our church and it was tough. He was here from Nashville. I said, that was probably the longest 11 hours of his life because you rerun your sermons, you know, but he never recovered. Now he's a student, which means that there's, you know, I mean, you're gonna die in some sermons. But when I was a freshman, all freshmen had to preach Vesper at American Baptist College. Vesper is just chapel service. And so I was such a punk. Those dudes hated me. I don't think today they know my first name is Keith. Here come Pass. Here come Pass. So when Pass had to preach his Vesper service, it was packed because they coming for a funeral.
Yeah, they just know.
They know I'm going to die in this. No, not that night. No, not in front of y'all. And then I got to hear it every day. I got to hear it every meal, walking through the hallways. You know, so no, it's an enormous, but I think it's singers. You know, like you go in, I'll never forget, and boy, I got to give her credit. Patti LaBelle and Aretha Franklin was at the White House for Barack Obama. Aretha is the diva. Aretha's always going to be last. Aretha's going to wear her fur coat, even though she shouldn't. I mean, that was Aretha. That night, Patti wrecked the house. Patti wrecked the house. It was, and all Aretha could do was Aretha, but that night it was Patti.
Well, that's no different than... And to me, let me say what you want to say. Etta James totally hated on, who was that? Beyonce.
Beyonce.
Oh, yeah.
Cadillac
Records. Yeah.
Because of the song. And she felt like, oh, they should have asked me. It ain't like I'm dead. I'm still alive. They want my song, but they don't want me.
See, but that's that old stubborn, you know, things that people go through. They don't want to let it go. They don't want to see somebody else new come in and do what they're doing, which in reality is not right. That's just being stubborn.
Well, I think if they had thought it through,
well, Beyonce,
it would not have been out of place to invite her, to have her there, maybe even tribute her in some way by having Beyonce sing the song.
But they did, though, because that song is what she sung. So
she wasn't even invited.
Yeah. I mean, though,
there's something else going on.
Yeah,
there.
I mean, come on,
something
man.
Else going on.
See, because for them to actually put that song in the movie, and they gave her credit.
Well, no, I'm not talking about the movie. I'm talking about at the inauguration.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, look, Layla Hathaway never got invited on any national program to sing her daddy's song, and she complained about it for the first time. She got, you got everybody on here singing my daddy's song, but me.
Was she outside town?
No, she's a Hathaway.
Yeah, who's a great voice? She could still be outside.
Oh my God, she is an incredible. Would she be alto tenor?
Yeah, she is. Incredible. She is good. I love her style. It's her dad.
It's her dad, and her dad was just smooth.
So now the story was that he jumped out of a window.
Right.
You believe that?
Yeah, because he was dealing with. He was dealing with paranoia, schizophrenia, and they noticed that his behavior became more and more bizarre.
I'll tell you what I did note. If you listen to most of his music, it's also melancholy and kind of down. And, you know, I love you more than you'll ever know. And, you know, just all of that. It all kind of stayed in that vein to me.
Yeah, I think that artist is like somebody else who ended up dealing with mental challenges was Phyllis Hyman. And when you listen to some of her albums, especially after she broke up with her husband, it was a lot of pain. It was, you know, you come through it. Some people have argued that they love Mary J. Blige when she was going through stuff as opposed to this new Mary. Because you bring there's a Greek word called pathos, where we get that word passion. And because you guys were talking about the anointing, and Christianity was known as charisma. It's a gift. I mean, you draw people to you. And so people will put their pain into their music. Your life experience, it goes in and becomes a way that you can exhale, you know, through your pain. All these gay gospel musicians who were getting bullied when they were young, a lot of that pain is in their music. Right. I mean, you know, Mother LaValle told the story about Jeffrey. She said that they used to pick on Jeffrey so much and Jeffrey just come in and take it out on the piano. Right. I mean, you know, so I think all artists, you're going through what you're going through and the pain. Who's my guy with Nirvana?
Kurt Cobain.
I mean, And people loved about it. But when you listen to the music, it was dark. It was like, oh my God.
And you can feel it too.
Yeah, it's like, whoa, this is a heavy, you know, the thing about gospel music is that usually at the end of it, it's a happy ending, right?
Yeah.
I went through what I went through. But God was there and God delivered me. And you can talk about all you went through, but there was a positive ending, right? And I think that sometimes, and maybe sometimes it's just open. My pain is just my pain. It's an open wound. And we're able to express it. And then here's the other thing. Once dollars get involved with it, people could care less about what your life struggles are. You need to get on the stage, man. Caller, welcome to the program.
Time though, it's still like the blues. It make you happy, it make you sad.
Oh yeah, real talk.
It smile and make you cry.
Yep.
So what's the difference when I really looked at it?
Yeah, there's a song out, and they use I'll take you there.
I know what place.
Right, and there's another song. Somebody did a little gospel song where they then put gospel lyrics, different lyrics to the song. But everybody heard
Yeah.
I mean, it gets to there. In my mind, there is no difference. You know, blues are expressing an emotion, a pain, an experience. Gospel music. Gospel. Now that's different than hymns. Hymns are praise songs, you know, that you send up to the Creator. Gospel music is a little bit different, though. They said it's supposed to be spreading the good news. Gospel kind of encompasses a whole lot of things. And then it's also Scots-Irish, and it's also African. And you know, you combine these things, and then we get this beautiful thing called gospel music. Caller, welcome to the program. Good morning.
Good morning.
How are you?
I'm doing good. Am I there? I'm sorry.
Yes.
Yes.
So, hey guys. First of all, Debo, man, what an incredible voice. Who knew you could go like that, dude? And why aren't you recording? First of all, two questions. First of all, Carlton Pierce said before he died, there would be no good gospel music without the gay men singing. There is no good gospel music out there. All of it is.
I agree.
There ain't no good gospel. That pain, no, I guess that pain. I mean, there is, but that pain, like you said, somehow it's transferred. Somehow it's somehow that plight, being a disfavored group, somehow it's transferred. You can clearly tell. Secondly, is church becoming entertaining now? And so take the organ out of church. Is church just going? I mean, is it now just thing? Is it? Are we just moved by the organ? And is it really good?
Well,
I got that question now. Are we being moved? Is it take the organ away, or is it just are we just going to get a little some sanctified entertainment? Some evangelical good time.
Can I answer that after the break?
Let's call it. We're going to place you on a brief hold. We're going to go ahead and take the break. We got to pay some bills because we'll have to get Northwest Funeral Chapel in. So we want to be certain that we can get your question out there and let folks hear it. Just hold on for us, Keith. You want to take us to break?
We're inside. Say Something Real. Keith Paris sitting in for Michelle Bryant. We're going to take a quick break and we'll be right back.
If you're looking for mouth-watering eats and delectable treats, look no further. Eat local and visit the Sherman Phoenix today, where you can find everything from delicious organic wings and smoked barbecue to satisfyingly seasoned vegan food to sweet, buttery, made-to-order desserts. The Sherman Phoenix is also home to a day bar serving mixed, frozen, and tropical drinks. Experience the Sherman Phoenix effect at 3536 West Fond du Lac Avenue. Open Tuesday through Friday, 11 a.m. to 7 p.m. and Saturday, 10 a.m. to 7 p.m. Visit theshermanphoenix.com to learn more.
My name is Michael S. Harper, and I'm running for Milwaukee County Comptroller. Yes, this is the position that monitors the county's financial accounts monthly and reports to the county executive and board as to their correctness and accuracy. The comptroller and team handles many other fiscal duties and analysis affecting the county. My qualifications include being a former trustee and chairman of Milwaukee County Employees Retirement System, an entrepreneur and small business owner, financial representative with Northwestern Mutual, and an instructor with the University of Phoenix MBA program, and so much more. Right now, you can go to the polls and vote early for Michael S. Harper for Milwaukee County Comptroller and be confident Milwaukee County's financials are in great hands for years to come. Michael S. Harper, a servant leader who strives to be a champion for the people and prioritize economic growth and prosperity. He is somebody for everybody.
This message was approved and paid for by friends of Michael S. Harper. Serena Harper, Treasurer.
Hey, Milwaukee, get ready for a breath of fresh air with Community Heartbeat, your go-to show for health and wellness in our vibrant city. Tune in the last Friday of every month to join us on a journey toward a healthier Milwaukee. Community Heartbeat is not just a show. It's a movement dedicated to bringing our community together through wellness. Call in during our live show the last Friday of every month from 7 a.m. to 9 a.m. Share your thoughts on social media using hashtag Community Heartbeat, and let's build a healthier Milwaukee together.
Increase in taxes while families are paying more for everything from gas to groceries is wrong. Milwaukee voters should oppose increase in property taxes by nearly 30% in order to provide increased funding yet again to Milwaukee Public Schools. They've already wasted nearly $1 billion in new taxpayer funding, and now they want more? They don't even have a plan on how they'll spend it. Enough is enough. Milwaukee voters should just say no.
Paid for by Enough is Enough. Vote no.
Hi, this is Keith Paris, the host of Community Voice, asking you to join us Mondays through Fridays from 9 to 11. You will hear from interesting guests, Wednesday's Word, and topics and subjects that impact our beloved community.
And don't forget about me, Devon Jones, DJ The Protege, here every Friday, bringing you Free Flow Friday, Politics Nation, Sports, Haters Nation, local events, national events. And remember, while I'm here, there'll be no passes given.
That's Community Voice, heard on The Voice, WNOV 860, 106.5.
WNOV 860 and W293CX 106.5 Milwaukee.
Welcome back to Community Voice. Greg, go on, man, real quick as we wrap up. Good morning. Greg, you still there? Hello? Yeah, you still there?
Here, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Okay, go on.
Yeah. So, you know, I'm just afraid of that. You know, sometimes when the message is over, you go, hey, what was the message about? I don't know, but they, we sure did have a good time, shouted and danced.
That's my experience every time I get up and preach. Okay. Yeah, no clue to what I preached about.
You know, I labored 40 hours for a message, and then, you know, that's all that's appreciated. That last, and I'm mimicking that because I'm not a hooter. I'm mimicking. You know, I'm just, I'm thinking, wow. You know, and I'm sick and tired of mimicking my end. I'm done with that. I'm a clone, and if no one get out of hoop, then I am. I'm changing my whole man. You know, and you didn't preach good. Why? Because I didn't hoop. And then when I do, I'm disingenuous because I don't. I'm well, not. You know.
What denomination are you, Greg?
I'm an ordained charismatic elder. Okay.
Right. You know, see, so you're not a Baptist. You're not a Baptist preacher. So Baptist preachers, we got to go to the cross every Sunday. We go to the cross every Sunday. And then I go to visit other traditions. I'm going, y'all go to the cross?
Like, no, I'm not.
Every Sunday. Not the place to the soul every Sunday. But, you know, I got ordained under Bishop Daniels. Served with Elder Hines for 25 years. Prison ministry, I've been 25 years. So, you know, I've been up under the best, and I've always felt like constrained and restrained on because my clothing weren't harmonious and harmonic and melodious. And all
you,
that. So
do you, man? There was a great, he's gone home to glory now. My guy, what's his name? He's out of Houston, Texas, Patterson. This dude could not hoop. He could not hoop at all. But I tell you what, you go to Congress, you go to convention, that man get up and preach. By the time he's finished, you ain't a dry eye in the house. It's your charisma. It's your gift. That's why God called all of us, because we all have our unique gifts, and one size does not fit all. Real quick, just to respond to why churches are looking the way they're looking, it's just more modern. It just, you know, I think you're trying to attract people who have a different sensibility, has a different sense of what visuals look like, and so it is what it is. Appreciate you, man. Wow. I have the great honor to have in studio with us today the pastor of Grace Fellowship Church of Milwaukee, Pastor Andrew Calhoun. Good morning, sir.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning.
So TSU Tiger.
I'm TSU Tiger ITC.
Okay.
Atlanta.
Okay.
Well, TSU Tiger twice. I got my bachelor's and master's from TSU, and then Master of Divinity from ITC, and I got a THM from Trinity down the road.
Okay.
Served as a Navy chaplain for about 12 years.
Okay. Yeah. Beautiful city of Nashville. When I was a student in Nashville, you mentioned earlier Fisk. Uh-huh. Young lady I was dating at the time here, she went to become part of Modern Black Mass down at Fisk. But the first Dr. King birthday commemoration I went to was at Little King's Garden.
Okay.
And it was Wyatt T. Walker.
Yep.
And I'll never forget what he preached that day. He said, don't ask what happened to the dreamer. Ask instead what happened to the dream. And that was Wyatt T. Walker. And if anybody familiar with Dr. King, know Wyatt T. Walker was his chief of staff at SCLC. And I thought, okay.
Yeah, a lot of people came through those channels, you know. It was like a who's who coming through, because I was there at the time when Too Tall Jones played for that, and then you had I was in classroom with Wilma Rudolph's daughter. I didn't know that until she showed up one day and talked to the class in history. I didn't realize that we were looking at a living legend, you know, right among us. And then to see all the different personalities come through, Julian Bond, you know, it was always somebody on campus who was of some history maker person.
Were you down there with Jefferson Street, Joe Gillum?
Yes, Jefferson Drove. Yeah. I saw Walter Payton.
Yeah, because you guys are still in the SWAC. They're in the Ohio Valley now.
And was Doug Williams.
Yep,
all them guys, and then the basketball guys who came through.
You know, there was a guy named Hubert Drumgo. He was American Baptist didn't have a basketball team, so I ended up playing with this guy who was a Tennessee State. He played basketball there. Harold Nero.
Okay.
And so he would take me in, and so we would go. And on Sundays, It's crazy, man. I'm at American Baptist. All I want to do is play basketball. I'm at a preacher school. All I want to do is play basketball. So we play on Sundays. And that's when all the ex-football players for TSU, sure, they would play in that league. I weighed 165 pounds. They throw me around like, but it was good. And then to interact with that history, some of these guys were still playing pro ball. And to think about TSU and what Tennessee State represented there. But then they got absorbed into the UT system now.
Yeah, also there were when it was a Brenda Moorhead, mm-hmm, Cassandra Cheeseborough, and Kathy McMillan.
Yeah.
They would come to church, you know.
What church were you attending when you were
attending? Gospel Tabernacle.
Okay.
And the thing about it was like, and we always would have, we were entertaining like Fist, the Russ College Singers, mm-hmm, come through. Usually you want to use our hall to practice and, you know, to go someplace else. So it was always that kind of connectivity. Yeah, it was a kind of interesting time.
How do you, you know, as we get to, because there's an event you're having at your church, mm-hmm, and we were just having a pretty wide range conversation this morning about, can we say black religion?
Yeah. Sure.
What do you see those challenges? Are there challenges now to our faith? I was reading the Sunday school lesson, and they put in there, and I didn't know if I agree with it, that, you know, Christians are being persecuted. I think if you're in a Muslim country, that's true. Non-American Christians dominate the world, right? When you look at power, is Christianity. But in terms of us, we were reminiscing about how in the day we spent so much, young people spent so much time in church.
Correct.
Not so much now.
Yeah, I agree with you 100%. I think now we're in the midst of a mixing pot of different ideas, whether it's the social justice kind of concept, which has always been there, but now is more prevalent. And you look at health disparities, we're dealing with economic stuff, and we're having a hard time sorting it all out. And then how do we redefine or bring it in where that it makes sense for the black church? Because we're struggling between what we used to be and then what we are today, and a lot of people are having a hard time making that transition.
Do you think that in terms of how we were given religion, you know, many of us, our ancestors, when they came here, they certainly weren't Christian.
Correct.
Some could have been Muslims. Many Correct. Probably were animists. And so now we basically adopt a religion,
mm-hmm,
and it's Eurocentric in a lot of ways.
Correct.
How do we now, in terms, you were talking about social justice issues and how much do we have to unlearn in terms of some of the religion we learned during enslavement that we've kind of held on to?
Well, I think that's the whole notion behind that whole DEI thing, mm-hmm, going on now, is to suppress or to push out some of the basic learnings that we can transfer to our next generation. But I'm thinking that's where the struggle is for us, is trying to say, okay, how can we get back to our norms?
Mm-hmm.
We know how the church has gotten this far. We read back over the history and church anniversaries. We go back, who were the people who laid down the bricks, the foundation, and the church today does not look anything like it used to be in the past.
Right.
We used to have, with the time we used to have, everybody had a choir, right? Everybody had a choir. Now it's a praise team.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So we changed the whole matrix. You have a choir stand behind the pulpit, but now it's nothing. I mean, it's just, you know, you got a background screen. So we're making some kind of progress, but we're trying to sort it all out.
Yeah. And I, you know, I always say that sometimes people want change, but they don't really want change. They want different. Okay. You know, they still want to stay status quo, but just make it look real different. And so now when we look at one of the largest groups of people, when we start, Pew talks about this in terms of religion, are people who are non-affiliated. It's like 25% of the population. How do we continue to make our message relevant to people when they come into church?
That is where we are.
Okay.
That's where the rub's at now, is and how can you put that message together? Because it's one thing, there's suburban message, all right? But then the urban message, okay? And then have we abandoned all the people who live in urban communities? And I think we're still struggling with that. As I go on the seminary, it says, you're wrestling with the text. You got to wrestle with the text. You got to, it's got to talk to you, you know. But in your social context, we're struggling with that.
Yeah, and I always say this. I think that you should have Gethsemane moments.
Sure.
You know, and as we in the midst of Passion Week. But I just wonder in terms of where we are in the messaging, how do we, or will it just organically become something where younger people will kind of create their own thing that's probably outside of, because you're seeing now more and more churches are getting away from brands like Baptist Church of God in Christ.
Sure.
You know, because
they dropping it off their name moniker on the front screen,
right,
on front street. Yeah.
Yeah. And I think that that probably how people, because it really is a brand.
Well, yeah. Yeah. The Assembly of God, a lot of them have gone through rebranding.
Well, Embassy, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, Discover out there in Oak Creek.
Right. That I drove by there. That it's used Discover. To be Oak Creek, right?
Yeah.
Park Lawn is now the Embassy. Uh-huh. Oh, do you think that that's so that makes it more attractive to people?
I think so. I think it's just a coming of age.
Okay.
I just think it's coming of age. It's just it's one of the new nuances that really is happening, and we're trying to find our footing because the new generation of kids coming up don't have the historical baggage like we know,
right,
to connect things on.
And understanding the social and emotional benefit that churches had for descendants of enslaved African people and enslaved African people,
sure,
that, you know, in effect, I know I have a caller who's he's pretty hostile when it comes to church and God. And but I have to gently remind him that that little bit of hope got my grandmother through.
Absolutely.
Now I have the benefit now of an education, and I can sure. go and we can have all these conversations about theology. And but for my grandmother, who just finished the 11th grade, she just needed hope to get her up the next day and get her through the day.
Sure, my mother could go no further than 8th grade because the Black high school was across the county.
Wow,
it had no transportation there.
Okay,
but she was my foundational teacher. At home, after school, you know, the teacher, basic stuff like this, and you look at the strength and the courage that they went through. But the church was the only thing that was common to everybody. Everybody had summer revivals, you know, they had the homecoming service like this, and there was time to get together and socialize and get to know people.
And I think that the social aspect of it is sometimes kind of, you can have great preaching.
Sure.
You can have a great choir.
Correct.
But it's nothing like how people feel,
correct,
when they come into that space.
Sure.
And that goes beyond the preaching, that goes beyond the choir.
Correct.
It is that
the fellowship. Connection. Yeah. It's family.
And I think it's COVID community. Really, even though, you know, we can still now we do Zoom and have an electronic church, there's nothing like being in a real church experience when Dr. Sims died, Donnie Sims.
Sure.
And it was in the middle of COVID. And one of the few churches that was still open for funeral services was Holy Redeemer.
Sure.
And not only did I have enormous respect for Dr. Sims, I just wanted to go to church.
Correct.
I mean, be in church.
Sure.
And even though it was a funeral.
Sure.
And I think a lot of other people were having that feeling too. So we ended up having church.
Sure.
And that's therapeutic.
Absolutely.
My pastor, Pastor Wanzo, he wasn't an emotional guy, but he says, yeah, they just need to come in and have this cathartic moment, so I'll let them shout. We had a young lady at our church and found out about her life, and it was very difficult for her. And she would get happy, and she would really get happy. And so, of course, you know, we're at a Baptist church. We had to shut that down. So they send the ushers up, and they're just trying to fan her and calm her down. And I thought, I heard what I heard, and I remember she kept saying, nigga, don't touch me. Nigga, don't touch me, in the middle of her shout.
Okay.
I'm going, what was that? But then when I knew her life,
sure,
let her, she needed to just exhale. She needed
sure.
to holler. She
yeah, needed to was scream. The old folks would say that the church was a hospital.
Yeah.
But they'd say, what kind of hospital?
Right.
So for me, it was like time was even at ITC, a music instructor says, well, you know, the church is a place where people can really let loose their intentions. And then you don't know how that's going to come out. and if the music's right and the song's right and the rhythm is right, then also you have this explosion. And people, it's therapeutic. It helps people deal with trauma. I help them to heal, and they leave out there because they feel reconnected.
And that kind of gets to this holistic approach to to how we do ministry. It gets us into what you're doing.
Yes.
In terms of and look, I'm a Matthew 25 guy. I think it for me it hinges on Matthew 25. Did we feed you when you were hungry? Did we clothe you when you were naked?
Absolutely.
Did we visit you when you were sick or when you were in prison? That's what Jesus, and it's really interesting because Jesus said, this is how you inherit eternal life. But it is that idea that, and I think that was kind of getting to the theology that we were taught, you can defer good health here because guess what? You're going to get it in heaven.
Sure.
And for a lot of people, they would then, it kind of permeated how we thought about things where, you know, I'll suffer down here, but that's okay. But you don't have to suffer unnecessarily.
Correct.
And that gets us
and this gets in here
to the health issue, right?
Yeah, healthy living for us. And in our church, one of our goals this year was to try to live healthy, to give people the information and knowledge about living healthy with diabetes. We're doing a partnership research study with School of Pharmacy, University of Wisconsin-Madison. And we're going to have our first training, 6 weeks training, beginning April 9th. At Grace Fellowship Church, and we just need 15 participants, basically. And you can call 414-550-1016. And if you're an African American, have type 1 diabetes, type 2 diabetes, or pre-diabetes, or gestational diabetes, you can call and register for our program. We provide meals. We have Black facilitators. We have compensation for you. It's going to be on Tuesdays from 5:30 to 8 o'clock for 6 weeks. And you have a discussion with the research team. We're trying to improve the outcomes of African-Americans because diabetes is one of those silent killers in our communities.
That sugar.
With 14% of African-Americans in Wisconsin who are suffering with some form of these diabetic outcomes here. And you look at, in fact, I got a 2023 note here that says that there are 1,560,000 people in Wisconsin, 34% of the adult population who have pre-diabetes with blood glucose levels that are higher than normal, but yet high enough to be diagnosed as diabetes. So you're looking at 1 in 5 in Wisconsin. So you start looking at that down the road. We're just trying to help people little bit by little bit live a better life because diabetes also affects your eyesight. And we got to be able to put things into how to eat right proportionally to get our exercise right. We've got to learn these things. And sometimes we got to be reinforced. It's just like coming to church. You come to church every, you can't be a first and third Sunday saint. You got to be every week. You improve your outcome spiritually.
And then we look at people who are hypertensive or people who are diabetic. What we discovered, there was a term that I had heard, but I really began to truly get the depth of what it really meant was comorbidities, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so during COVID, what we discovered was that there were people who, because of particularly diabetes,
sure,
they were more susceptible.
Yes. Than
to a more acute onset of COVID, and sure, people end up losing their lives in some instances. Correct. And the thing about diabetes and hypertension is that a lot of this is basically lifestyle.
Yeah, correct. I did a year residency at Aurora Healthcare a couple of years ago, and being a resident chaplain there, and so many of the cases that I dealt with, you find people had diabetes. And that was hindering or another thing for the doctors to navigate around dealing with the COVID. Mm-hmm. And that, you know, they were just shaking their head, says, you know, this throws something else into the wrench. And how do you balance this out? And I need to give, you know, whether you have to do, you know, to clean their blood, you've got to do all kinds of stuff. And it just
look
really
at the number of Black people who are dealing with dialysis
dialysis
as a direct result of diabetes.
Correct.
All right. You're listening to Say Something Real. I'm sitting in for Michelle Bryant. We're going to be back with Pastor Calhoun right after the break.
J.C. Fraser.
Good morning, brother. Good morning, everyone. This is J.C. Fraser with Northwest Funeral Chapel, inviting your attention to the following announcement. Funeral services for Ms. Dorothy Lewis will be held on Wednesday at 1 p.m. at Northwest Funeral Chapel. Funeral services for Ms. Hilda Holmes Swan will be held on Thursday at 11 a.m. at Northwest Funeral Chapel. Funeral services for Mr. Michael Richards Sr. will be on Friday at 11 a.m. at Northwest Memorial Chapel. Let us continue to remember in our prayers the family of Mr. Isaac Nation Sr. If you would like to offer your condolences to our families, you may do so by visiting our website at northwestmemorialchapel.com. We invite you to join us here each week for these announcements from Northwest Memorial Chapel. We're located at 6630 West Hampton Avenue. Our phone number is 414-462-6020. This is J.C. Fraser wishing each of you a safe and pleasant day. Now, thought from our Sunday school lesson for Sunday, March 31st, 2024. The title of this week's lesson is The Resurrection, Key to Faith. The scriptural text for this lesson is taken from Mark chapter 16, verses 1 through 8. Reading from the New Living Translation of the Bible, verses 1 through 5, read as follows. Saturday evening, when the Sabbath ended, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James and Salome, went out and purchased burial spices so they could anoint Jesus' body. Very early on Sunday morning, just at sunrise, they went to the tomb. On the way there, they were asking each other, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb?" But as they arrived, they looked up and saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled aside. When they entered the tomb, they saw a young man clothed in a white robe sitting on the right side. The women were shocked. In this portion of our lesson, we see three women who were followers of Christ, even to his death. They had seen the place where he was buried, and as soon as the Sabbath was over, that was Saturday evening, they went out to purchase spices that would be used to anoint his body. Just the sunrise on Sunday morning, they went to the tomb, not knowing how they would roll away the stone from the entrance. To their surprise, the heavy stone was already removed, and the tomb was empty. They were frightened when they went into the tomb and saw a man clothed in white, sitting on the right side. As we come to the close of Women's History Month, let us remember those women whose dedication to our Lord helped them overcome their fears, and they became the first to be carriers of the message of the resurrection. In spite of what others may say or do, let us, by faith, believe that the Lord can and will use us as carriers of his message. Now, hear these words. But tell me this, since we preach that Christ rose from the dead, why are some of you saying there will be no resurrection of the dead? Well, if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, then all our preaching is useless and your faith is useless. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead. He is the first of a great harvest of all who have died. Who said that and what was he talking about? Ask your teacher and we'll see you in Sunday school.
Say something real.
Hi, and welcome back. And we're joined in studio again by Pastor Andrew Calhoun there of the Grace Fellowship Church in Milwaukee. And he's talking about a partnership he has with the University of Wisconsin-Madison School of Medicine. And this is doing the School of Pharmacy, right?
Yes.
So how important, you know, people do 6 weeks. So is this like we're going to talk about lifestyles? We're going to talk about...
To my lifestyles, what you... nutrition is a big one, lifestyle, and also the need for exercise, whether it's walking or how many steps you need to do, lifting barbells, sitting still, whatever, because it always improves the outcomes when you're active in the process. And again, if you want to become part of this study, you can dial 414-550-1016 and then get you registered for this particular program. If you have type 1 diabetes, type 2, pre-diabetes, or gestational diabetes, you can become part of this study.
I think, and we're talking in a little bit later in my program, I'm covering for Michelle and hers, on Tuesdays we have a segment, Be Healthy, Be You.
Sure.
And we talk a lot about different health issues. And we spend a lot of time talking about diabetes. Sure. I was kind of chuckling to myself when you say meals. The movie Soul Food, I don't know if you saw that movie. They sure. had. And so they always had that Sunday dinner. We were talking about fellowship, right?
Absolutely.
Catfish, fried chicken, macaroni and cheese.
And greens.
Greens with ham hocks. And Big Mama had diabetes. Mm-hmm. And a lot of it had to do with that food. So I thought it was real interesting that when they came together, they had the very food that killed Big Mom. And I guess I'm getting to the point, you know this as a preacher. For adults, we have to unlearn.
Absolutely.
In order then to learn.
Sure.
And the older we get, the more difficult it is for us to unlearn.
Sure.
Because they've been with us so long. Our eating habits are our eating habits.
Absolutely.
And
that's so, one of our biggest culprits right there.
Right.
And then sometimes we think we always got to eat. We have to eat. And it's what you particularly eat makes all the difference. So we're going to go through all those. In fact, the meals we're going to that's going to be served here are going to be the kind of meals that you need to have in order to you got to put away that salt shaker. You know, you got to minimize certain things.
Come on, man.
And
the salt shaker, man. Come on.
So you have to do things like that.
You ever see people salt the food? Haven't even tasted it. Just loading it up.
After it's already been seasoned.
Right.
Then they go add more salt on.
And hadn't tasted it yet. They're just habitual in how we can change. And because I'm hypertensive, I'm really salt sensitive.
Sure.
And sometimes I'm pretty good about, you know, I went to the movies and I hadn't eaten all day. So I decided to get me a big old thing of popcorn with butter and salt. And my blood pressure shot up because I'm not used to having that salt intake, you know.
Sure.
I've never been a sweet guy. So that was never an issue with me. But salt, man, I didn't. So when you think about diabetes and the foods we eat, my brother discovered that he was pre-diabetic, and my brother's really fastidious about his diet, exercise, the whole thing. So when they told him, so he stopped eating pasta, but he started eating fruit, and the sugar in the fruit was such that it just sent him up in terms of what his numbers are like. So it is that change. I think the other thing is the availability of those healthy foods and how do we prepare it?
Yes, and especially, you know, the news is not good when you look at Milwaukee being designated as, you know, one of those food deserts.
Food desert, yeah.
And, you know, we've getting all kind of labels. That means people that have accessibility to fresh foods and then or the price of them.
Right.
It's another hindering part of it. I think it's a combination, but what can you do? is our quest here, is that how can I help you extend? Because the cost of going to the emergency room, the cost of going here is just astronomical. Right. And then it just takes away everything else you're trying to do, trying to help a longer, healthier life. I've lost a young cousin for pre-diabetes. I lost him. He was in his 30s.
Yeah.
Unchecked, not going to the doctor regularly, and led to one thing to another, and be unchecked.
Pastor Andrew Calhoun of the Grace Fellowship Church of Milwaukee. Again, this is a healthy living study.
Yes.
And if you're interested in being part
April
of
the study, 9th starts.
Starts April 9th, so you need at least 15 people.
Yeah, at least 15.
All right, and they can call, you can call 414-550-1016, 414-550-1016.
Or you can go to my church's Facebook page. We have it listed there, plus a QR code. You can line in yourself that way. You can register that way as well.
Let me thank Pastor Calhoun. Let me thank Debo. Oh, no, I got to come back. So let Michelle, thank you for letting me sit in for you inside Say Something Real. Bye.
Say something real. There were soldiers in a revolution. There's a war.